senior scientist at Aalto University in Finland. So he is a cognitive neuroscientist who used imaging and psychophysics to do to investigate perceptual and cognitive functions, and including emotion and social cognition. So today he's going to share with us some of the work he has done to use movies as naturalistic stimuli in fMRI study. So welcome.
Okay, thanks. Can you actually put the lights down a little bit?
I'm going to do that.
Okay. All right, thanks very much, Monica, for the introduction. And it's always a pleasure to be here in Boston and Martino Center. Brings back many good memories. And today my topic that I'm going to talk to you about is the use of movies as affective social stimuli in functional magnetic resonance imaging studies. And so, as you probably all are aware, the fMRI is a fairly new method. It was developed in the early 1990s by Bellavo, Ogawa, many others. The signal you get is based on the differential magnetic properties of blood that's oxygen rich and oxygen depleted. And what is important when we consider using movies as stimuli is that the bold fMRI provides a time course of local hemodynamic activity for each voxel of the brain. And why so? As you can see, a simple time course here for the photic stimulation from Kwang, 1992. The movie is actually based on or composed of time courses. So the occurrence of faces, different social actions, emotion eliciting stimuli, they can be all decomposed to time courses. So then you can, with proper signal data analysis tools, put those two together, the movies and the brain activity. But why would one need to use naturalistic stimuli such as movies and fMRI studies? Certainly a lot has been accomplished with simpler stimuli, some might say more better controlled stimuli than movies. But there's been arguments that I think there are fairly good ones for the significance of using naturalistic stimuli such as movies as complementary measures. And first of the arguments proposed by Spears and McGuire in TICS 2007 is that because many studies use simplified static stimuli, surprisingly little is known about how the human brain operates during real-world experiences. And first of all, it would be vital to verify whether results obtained in experiments with simple stimuli generalize to natural conditions. And then they give even an example of two brain regions, such as fusiform face area, to show selectivity also in the case of naturalistic stimulation. And then, of course, and perhaps more importantly, some research questions can only be addressed with naturalistic tasks. Okay, so why have movies not been used in fMRI studies until quite recently? So I think the key here is that suitable data analysis methods were lacking, and you have to appreciate, of course, that the fMRI hasn't been around for that long. And I say that the primary argument against using movies probably has been that it's assumed that fMRI would result in complex data with spatial and temporally overlapping responses during watching movies without a baseline against which to contrast the activations. Now, fortunately, in practice, any given voxel seems to respond to relatively few aspects of a complex movie stimulus. So the data analysis challenge may not be as great as you'd assume at first hand. The pioneering work was published in 2004. In the first study, Andreas Bartels and his colleagues showed healthy volunteers the first 22 minutes of a James Bond movie, Tomorrow Never Dies, during fMRI. They quantitated the occurrence of colors, faces, language, and human bodies in this short movie clip, and were able to model different visual cortical areas with the time courses of occurrence of these features. Then in a second study published just 2 months after the first one, Yuri Hassan and colleagues presented a 30-minute movie clip taken from The Good, Bad, and the Ugly to subjects during fMRI scanning. And they did something that was quite simple, but yet powerful. They correlated the individual subjects at bold time series like this, showing here. You take the single voxel from subject one, and then you correlate with another subject with a fairly simple Pearson correlation coefficient. And what they saw that especially the sensory cortical areas showed significant intersubject correlations during watching of this movie. And as you can see here, taken from the 2004 science paper of Hassan and colleagues. And this does provided a new method to study how individual brains respond alike during watching a complex stimulus. And then they also used a reverse correlation approach. So they identified brain regions showing high intersubject correlation values. Then they took the bold time series of all subjects, calculated the mean, and then the variance over the whole time course of the grand mean. And then they looked at individual peaks of activation, and they saw in this case, if you look at the fusiform area, the peaks there co-occurred with the presence of faces in the movie. And we've also looked at whether multivoxel pattern analysis methods can predict the occurrence of faces in a movie set. We trained the algorithm with one movie data, and then we looked at how well it predicted the annotations in another movie data set, and it indeed it seems to work very well. So there were the fusiform areas implicated along with some other occipital areas to predict the occurrence of faces in a movie. So to answer the simple question, do brain regions such as the fusiform face area also show selectivity when faces appear in the real world? Yes, the fusiform gyrus does this. Okay, that just as a proof of principle demonstration. But then on to the more interesting question, I think more interesting question. Some research questions can only be addressed with naturalistic tasks. And here we noted that movies induce more robust emotions in experimental subjects than more simple stimuli such as pictures, of which you can see examples on the screen here. Birthday cakes, people smiling. These are taken from the International Affective Picture System. Also movies depict dynamic social interactions that develop over time. So then potentially this enables one to study how the brain processes, for instance, intentions of others and emotions in social contexts. And what was curious also that the socio-emotional brain areas lacked the intersubject correlations in the Hassan et al. 2004 science study, especially the prefrontal cortical areas and the amygdala lacked intersubject correlation. And thinking of what could potentially explain this is that perhaps the subjects were not into the plot of the movie or the preceding context, because it was just an isolated 30-minute clip that was shown. And perhaps it was more perceived as a, random audiovisual stimulus. And what we did then, we showed the first 72 minutes of a movie Crash, directed by Paul Haggis, Lionsgate Films 2004. We showed that to 12 healthy volunteers who were naive to the movie in a mini movie theater to get them involved. And then the last 36 minutes we showed during treatised life MRI. And we selected the movie based on a high quality, and it was also identified as one eliciting robust emotions in movie viewers. Right after the scanning, the subjects were taken back to the mini theater and re-shown the last 36 minutes that they saw during the fMRI, and they were to rate their emotional feelings that they recollected having experienced during fMRI scanning. So they were to rate on a scale of 1 to 5 their emotional arousal from drowsy to excited and valence from negative through neutral to positive every 30 seconds. And this sort of the dimensional model of emotions where each emotion is modeled as a two dimensions, the valence and the arousal. There's a lot of literature on this in the emotion work. Okay, but what we saw that first of all, crash did elicit robust emotions in viewers. Here you can see the arousal and the valence as a function of time, and there's then the peak that shows very negative valence, high arousal. There's some screenshots of that. I'm not gonna just show briefly the most emotional scene from the movie Crash. It takes a so for some reason there's no sound. Okay, so when the context was added and the subjects were emotionally engaged, we did see significant intercepted correlations in the prefrontal cortical areas as well as amygdala in addition to sensory cortical areas. So you can see the plots on the inflated cortical surface. And it is a noteworthy observation that the prefrontal intercepted correlation was seen especially in the right hemisphere that is associated with processing of negative emotions. So this was quite a gloomy picture overall. It didn't have so many positive parts to it. And here you can see the medial surfaces of the prefrontal cortical areas. Okay, so that was the first observation that, okay, we can see prefrontal cortical activity synchronized in subjects when they're watching movies. Okay, but what factors give rise to this IC of prefrontal cortical bold activity? So there are some clues. First of all, the director does seem to make a difference. This is not our own work, but that of, again, Yuri Hasson and colleagues, where he showed multiple movies. Bottom right corner, you can see Washington Square Park free footage, so it's not a directed movie, and it causes very little intersubject correlation, and even that is in the sensory areas, whereas in the Alfred Hitchcock's Bang You're Dead, there you can see robust correlations in the prefrontal cortical areas as well. So the director seems to make a difference. One possible hypothesis is that perhaps there is something in the prefrontal cortical areas that relate to there being longer temporal receptive windows. because observing dynamic social interactions and build up and persistence of emotions, but also speech and music, these stimulations are distributed across time. So as a simple example, there's a very long word in English, anti-disestablishmentarianism, that lasts about 2 seconds. And Finnish would have a lot longer words, I had to sort of do some research to actually find this long one in English. And if you think in terms of different processing timescales, so the level of phonetic coding, of course, you need to have very short temporal receptive windows to react to individual phonemes. But if your neurons would be just sensitive to those, you wouldn't be able to understand language, because obviously you need to track or accumulate information over the whole time course of the 2 seconds to get the meaning of the word. Okay, and so this is another example from music. Hope I can play it here. Okay, so if you notice that the last note was missing from the repeat of the melody, it's taken from the Verdi's famous La Traviata. How many of you heard that the last note was missing? Okay, I hope not too many had heard this before, but obviously it's a very famous piece. But anyways, this shows that your brain is then successfully perceiving temporally distributed information over a timescale of about 8 seconds. And there are also these reports where people have used scrambled movies over different timescales, and they're also seeing this hierarchy of temporal receptive fields in the visual cortical areas. So to explore this possibility, we extended the intersubject correlation analysis to the frequency domain using wavelet analysis. We divided the fMRI to different subbands. Very slow ones, faster ones. Obviously, in the ball dynamics, there aren't really that fast ones, but going from ultra slow to less slow. But what we did see is that, as you can see, the green color indicating the very, very slow frequency band, the intersubject correlation at that frequency band dominated in prefrontal and anterior temporal areas. And there are some similar observations by others. As you can see here, the occipital cortex seems to, this is sort of taking a subject population, splitting it into two, and then plotting the two bold time series on top of one another. So you can see that the visual cortex seems to follow across all frequencies. But if you look at the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex here, the slow rhythms seem to go hand in hand, but the fast rhythmic activity here doesn't really seem to correlate. Okay, so one possible explanation, of course, is that social interactions take or accumulate over longer time periods, and maybe the prefrontal cortex is geared to detect that, and then that's reflected in this slow band correlation. Also, we wanted to test the hypothesis whether emotional engagement of the subjects increased intersubject correlations. And unfortunately, in our first study, we sampled the valence and arousal only once every 30 seconds, so we weren't really able to see whether these emotional states predicted bold activity. The only link we saw was between arousal and cerebellar bold activity. And also, one of the problems with this full-length crash movie is that it seemed to induce simultaneously positive and negative valence, which is incompatible with the bipolar valence scale that we were using. So we address this question by showing a set of emotional movie clips to subjects during fMRI and by obtaining continuous post-scan self ratings of experienced emotional valence and arousal. So here you can see the design. There's a fixation cross, description of the upcoming movie as to give them the context, and there's the movie clip that varied from 29 to 132 seconds, and then there's the washout period and the next. And after scanning, they viewed the clips twice. First, they rated their valence and then their arousal continuously. And here you can see one sample clip. These were all silent movies, and this is just across subjects' average bolt activity at single TR accuracy. So it's not the measure of intersubject correlation, but it does give you some idea of how the different brain areas are responding. This is a famous piece from The Godfather. So now the subjects are noticing that there is something wrong. They see the blood, and then of course there's the head of the horse. Yeah, so that's then a very robust prefrontal cortical bold activity. All right, well, we saw that the negative valence here plotted with the blue color, so just look at the blue color. The intersubject correlation was predicted by the negative valence in multiple brain structures, including the medial and lateral prefrontal cortical structures. This was published last spring in PNAS. And possible interpretations to this finding is that negative emotions are have been associated with narrowed mental focus and restricted processing styles. In contrast, positive emotions might broaden the possible behavioral repertoire and promote exploration of the environment. And perhaps the restricted processing due to negative emotions resulted in increasing of the intersubject similarity of human responses in emotional brain areas. Okay, so high arousal, which is here plotted with the red-yellow scale, was associated with increased intersubject correlation in multiple brain areas, including the somatosensory cortices, the visual cortex, bilateral intraparietal sulci, and frontal eye fields. So to some extent, maybe the visual processing, maybe attention, became more similar as arousal was going up in the subjects. Okay, so another aspect that I mentioned in addition to emotions is that movies depict social interactions, social signals and cues, and with movies we can investigate how the brain reacts to these. And this is something that we did recently. We presented 145 short clips, just about 20 seconds each. And the clips were chosen so that they contained predominantly certain social categories like faces, bodies, biological motion, goal-oriented action, emotion, social interaction, pain, speech, as well as some non-social categories. And here you can see a few examples of social interaction.
Oh, how have you been?
Good. Good, yes. Well, I thought I was on my way to work, but now somebody's arranging for a tuxedo for me, so I'm just going to say hello.
Okay, social interaction. Of course, it also contains faces, so there is some intercast. Here's an example of pain. Well, now it's not playing. Well, I have to. Okay. Well. And this is an example of non-social. So it's a sort of a control clip, just a rigid motion here. And as you can see here, we then had two persons annotate the presence of these different categories in across all the clips. So we obtain a time course for the presence of faces. Here you can see the inter-rate or reliability here. And for each of the categories, and here you can see that the while there were some correlations between certain categories like social interaction and speech obviously do correlate, but still it's a fairly modest correlation, so just 25% of shared variance. And then we looked at which brain areas responded to the different categories, and here you can see as a plot the number of categories that each brain areas responded to the number of social categories. And this really shows that the posterior superior temporal sulcus responds to each one of the social categories. Yes?
And this is still with ISC?
No, this is a GLM. Thanks for the clarification, yes. This is a simple GLM analysis using the time courses. And what was notable about the posterior STS as well is that it didn't respond to any of the non-social categories that we used. So when we titled the paper, the posterior STS is the hub of the social perception system of the brain. But you can also see some other brain areas to reacting to certain categories. We also run a functional complex network analysis on these, and we're able to identify four networks: frontal insular network, frontal temporal network, temporal amygdala network, and frontal parietal network, based on these data. So the size of the circle is the strength of the hub, and the size of the line is the strength of the connection in this visualization. There were some social cognition areas, such as ventromedial prefrontal cortex, that were not activated in this study using these social categories, and this may be because these movie clips, short ones, were chosen so that they did not engage the theory of mind or mentalizing processes in the subject. So we know, based on a recent meta-analysis that's here visualized on the brain, that the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, or the orbitofrontal cortex, is implicated in most of the theory of mind tasks and studies that have been used. And here, if you then compare across these to the meta-analysis in our study, you can see that there are common areas here in the different theory of mind tasks seem to, you know, most of the theory of mind studies also involve the posterior STS, but obviously our short movie clips fail to really activate the sort of the most often implicated theory of mind areas of the brain. But we have seen that the ventromedial prefrontal cortex does respond to in our subjects when they are watching movies and see high risk taking behavior in movie characters, such as here flirting with a stranger in nightclub. So you can see that the ventromedial prefrontal cortex is activating across subjects. And one thing that we just finished last week is that since we're a multidisciplinary university, we also have the TV and film studies department on board. So they just filmed in a TV studio, which is quite an impressive facility for a neuroscientist to visit. They filmed this movie that we designed together to stimulate the theory of mind. So looking forward to what type of results we're going to get in fMRI studies using that movie. And we use the green screen there, so basically any background can be put in. And of course, we have all the non-edited movie material at our hands, so we can do different versions, different camera angles, etc. So that gives us a lot of possibilities over just using existing movie material. Okay, so right now, as you have seen, there are fairly straightforward methods, good methods to analyze fMRI data obtained during subjects watching movies. But since we are Department of Biomedical Engineering and Computational Science, we like to improve the methods hand in hand with the empirical studies. And this last piece of my talk, I'm going to briefly explain you some recent method developments. So, first of all, there are some limitations to the intersubject correlation method, most notably that it offers a relatively poor temporal resolution. So there are, of course, many events in the movies that take place quite fast, and we need to calculate sliding windows over about 20 seconds currently to get time courses for the IC. And of course, you could use the type of reverse correlation approach that was introduced already back in 2004, where you take from the correlated areas these bold time series of all subjects, average them, calculate the variance, and then see which peaks go above the variance. But of course, you might have just a single subject here and there who has a activation peak, and anyways, this is sort of an indirect measure of intersubject synchronization of brain activity. Okay, and what we've been developing, and you can see all the details from the brain connectivity paper in 2012, is we've been implementing intersubject phase synchrony analysis. First, we identified a frequency band, because we have to use a narrow band to get the phase synchrony. And this was based on looking where there are typically more artifacts and exclude those bands from the analysis, and then just convert the individual time series to phase time series, where you have instantaneous single TR phase, and then you look across subjects whether the phase is common across time or different. And this is just a demonstration using looking at the visual cortical areas during watching of a movie, where you can see the intersubject correlation calculated over the whole time series and the average intersubject phase synchrony plotted here with the orange and yellow. They seem to agree remarkably well as to which brain areas show synchrony. And then if you look at how well the different time windows work when calculating intersubject correlation, so going to very short time windows, of course, you start having the sort of jittery signal with the red four time window. So with a TR 2 seconds, that's 8 second time window. The ISC with eight no, this might be second, maybe probably is TRs, yes, eight TRs. No, it's actually, it might be second, so it's four TRs. So that gives the closest to what we can get with the intersubject phase synchrony. But anyways, we can get the probably the best measure with the intersubject phase synchrony in terms of tracking how the brain activity is similar across time. And one additional thing that we're very excited about that this method allows us to do is to look at how the individual brain areas of a given subject synchronize at its given time instant, and moreover, how similar is that network synchronization across subjects. So then we can take a look at the similarity of dynamic network activity of the subjects at single TR resolution, and then we can calculate those types of also complex networks of dynamic brain activity. These were presented in the Society for Neuroscience meeting in 2011, but it's pretty much work in progress at this point. But and why is quantification of dynamic network activity important? So we believe it's important because we propose the functional role of a given brain area is dependent on the input-output patterns of the area. So just to give an example, the visual cortex seems to process visual stimuli, but it also seems to support visual imagery. So depending on whether it's a bottom-up stimulation or top-down stimulation, the same brain area can do different, carry out different tasks. We proposed that mapping the instantaneous connectivity would be the key to understanding brain function cognition relationships. Okay, so on to the conclusions. Movies, I believe, can be used as highly naturalistic affective social stimuli in fMRI studies to elucidate the neural basis of emotions and social cognition. I think we're still in the very beginning of this research avenue. The intercept correlation approach is a useful model-free analysis method, as well as the annotation in GLM and also ICA that we've been using. But anyways, analysis and imaging methods that offer higher temporal resolution, such as the interceptive phase synchrony, combined with these fast fMRI scanning sequences like the inverse imaging sequences developed here in the Martino Center some years ago, offer further possibilities for research in the future. And intersubject seed voxel-based phase synchrony allows one to study dynamic brain network activity and relate that to social cognition emotions. And of course, there are potential clinical research applications of these methods in the future as well. And this is just to acknowledge some of the people that we've been working with in the course of these studies. Thank you very much.